This is a story of survival, and how we'll do anything to ensure it. This is a story of disattachment, and how sometimes it's the only way to survive. This is a story of love, but it's not a love story. It's about how it amplifies pain to the point where we drive away those we love the most. It's about when there aren't enough drugs in the world to combat the noise. It's about when the only way is to walk away. This story is called Insensitive. I'm in a room. Four white walls and a bed. The two female voices above me gently pitch and volley their subject back and forth. Short strokes passing turn to the other. Neither the questions too probing, nor the answers too comprehensive. Like a heartbeat. Systole. Diastole. One of the voices should be familiar, I think, but I wouldn't swear to it, but neither was overly concerned. The slow, regular metronome beats of the heart monitor seemed to punctuate their conversation. Each beep, a bullet point of my life, just waiting for details to justify its existence. I first became aware of my disorder. It was one day at the beach. It was Frinton-on-Sea or Southend or somewhere. I can't be sure. The wife was sunning herself behind huge dark glasses, and the children were splashing and screaming in the waves. I saw it happen. Charlie, my youngest, was screaming and giggles of delight when the wave moved in and lifted him high before pulling him under. I watched it happen. The events evolved like a YouTube video behind a huge sheet of glass. And then there was screaming, mouths open, arms flailing. Dragged the body from the waves, and I had to drive fast. Her face was sodden, her eyes streaming, her mouth open, but I focused on the road. We had to stop at a red traffic light, and up next to us pulled this Citroen. You know, the one with the windscreen that goes up over the roof. I was involved with the advertising campaign for that. Incredible visibility. If you like driving a greenhouse. When we entered the hospital car park, it was full. So many sick. I spotted a car reversing from a space, and before anybody else could, I swung the car in. It's those little victories in life that make it all worthwhile. This was one of mine. Now, you can say what you like about the health service, but there's nothing like a limp four-year-old with purple lips to get him in action. And soon he was on a gurney, being bounced through big white doors into another part of the hospital. The wife was explaining what had happened to the nurse, fighting back the tears. I don't know why they didn't ask me. I watched her face, trying to understand the feelings behind them. And it was then that I realized there was something missing. There was something wrong. but I took the opportunity to go out and check my emails. When the doctor came out, he said it had been touch and go. The waves had shaken him like a martini. He was still pretty shaken up, but he would live. I'm sure I was relieved. The tide had taken him quite deep and he had taken on a lot of water. But it was then the first time that I was aware of it, because I knew something wasn't right. There was something missing. I realized I should have felt something, but I couldn't focus on what it should have been. I looked backwards and forwards from her face to his, trying to feel what was behind them. There was a ping in my pocket. It was Facebook. I told myself that it wasn't important right now, and checked the faces of my wife and the doctor before slipping the device from my pocket. It was a puppy meme. Puppy memes are the new cat videos. They're so cute. I replaced the device in my pocket, and their faces had changed. But I couldn't mimic this look. I still remember the events, but I couldn't tell you what it was. Something was wrong. That night, the wife stayed with the boy in the hospital and I took the other one home. I explained to him that Mummy wouldn't be coming home for a few days because his brother had nearly died, and Mummies like to be there when these things happen. He took it quite well. Well, why wouldn't he? I ordered pizza and I let him play on my tablet until long after his bedtime. When the kids came along, the soundtrack of our life changed. From nights at the pub with friends laughing, cozy nights on the sofa watching Netflix, to noise. The baby screamed all night, she screamed all day, and I tried to make it right. I got teething gels for the baby. I got babysitters so that we could take nights out together. I even bought a lingerie, but the lingerie stayed dusty in the drawer. The nights out were spent huddled over the phone awaiting the crisis call, and the baby continued to scream. I started to live a permanent state of fury, losing my temper for reasons I couldn't explain. The wife told me I wasn't being sensitive enough to her needs, and I could have argued that I was too sensitive to her frustration. Love amplifies pain, and when someone you love has forsaken happiness for obligation, the only viable act of self-preservation is detachment. I started drinking to muffle the pain, but that just made things worse. You see, alcohol allows you to say things that otherwise active parts of the brain would filter. The same parts of the brain that are wholly underdeveloped in bigots and zealots and people who speak too loud on public transport. Thing is though, once things are said, they can't be unsaid. Women collect pain like dogs collect fleas, ready to be shared on contact. We lost our friends. Those who had children had no time to visit. Those who didn't. You see, babies, they evoke jealousy and sympathy in equal measure. But in couples, mostly, a fear of contagion. My days became a circus of flying insults, apologies, and a cold back at bedtime growling you before snoring back into the next loop. Work required 110%. She demanded undivided attention. The kids needed complete care. And me? I got what was left. I think in the beginning, it was a conscious thing. I actually turned down the volume, and the more I did, the more it stayed down. Thankfully, the fatigue brought with it a warm, muffled haze of exhaustion. The pressure of work became a haven. The relationships were similar, but at least I wasn't supposed to care about any of them. I worked in marketing and I was bloody good. Advertising requires a finger on the pulse, an understanding of the great British consumer, empathy. And I had that in spades. You could take me out to any high street in the land, pick somebody out from the crowd, and I could tell you their motives and their drivers and their desires and what I'd have to tell them to make them buy the latest shit. But as the volume went down, I got better. They became faceless mannequins, units of consumption. You see, when you boil it all down and cut off the frilly edges, you want what she has, you want what he can't have. And you want more. I'd train myself not to want, not to need, not to desire. As the kids grew up, the wife grew old, and I began to wear my ties a little tighter. When they went to school, she went back to work. And after bedtime stories, she told me about how useless her boss was, all the flaws in her colleagues, and I did my best to say the right things before she left me on the sofa to wait for the alarm to signal the beginning of another day. And here I am. The room is empty now. It's just me and the slow, regular beeps of my existence. I open my eyes. Slight change in light, but little else. I remember events in Spartan detail, step by step, like history revision notes. Some of the events bleed into others, but mostly it's just bullet point information. Work was still going well. It was me that came up with the "buy these biscuits, they're better than the cheap ones" campaign. You must have heard it. I won an award for it. It became a cult classic. People said it was post-ironic. I couldn't see it myself. It was just a big faceless company wanting to sell more biscuits. So they got celebrities to tell you to do it. No brainer. My trips to the hospital began after an incident one Sunday. I could tell you the time and date as well, but that'd just be showing off. The kids were screaming and the wife was screaming at them to stop screaming. I was cooking chips, the potatoes bobbing around in the boiling oil, when all of a sudden, over my shoulder came a blue Hot Wheels car and landed with a plop. The oil splattered down my favourite Fred Perry shirt. Charlie, my youngest, exploded in tears. I plunged my hand deep into the oil and retrieved the car. I turned with the car in my outstretched palm. And I don't ever remember them looking at me like that before, staring at the car, the oil running from my arm, dripping from my elbow onto the carpet, the skin dripping from my fingers. I made promises to replace the car. The Fred Perry would come clean in the wash. All feeling evaporated like a sweat, replaced by a refreshing anesthesia. Food and sex lost their flavor. Watching films and reading books was just a waste of time. But I found myself watching the Discovery Channel, fascinated by the documentaries. So it wasn't all bad. At some point, walking became an issue. Even my relationship with the ground became tenuous until one day I took a tumble down the stairs, my arms and legs pirouetting above my head before I hit the floor with a sickening snap. Bones had articulated beyond normal tolerances and one was making its exit through my forearm. Getting up was impossible, but with my good arm I managed to retrieve my phone. I found an article on theguardian.com about Bitcoin. It was fascinating. When the children came back from school, they rushed straight to the living room to their tablets and PlayStations. It wasn't until the wife came back that the noise began again. She ferried the children next door to the neighbors. She phoned an ambulance, and I didn't get to finish the article on Bitcoin. In the back of the ambulance, the paramedics kept coming over and asking me where it hurt, and then going back and calling control, and then coming back and asking me where it hurt again, which became a pain in the ass. But I did manage to finish my article before we got to the hospital. That began my residency of the university hospital as an object of interest and research. The doctors were totally baffled. They tried dozens of cocktails of drugs for the pain to make me feel it. They gave me so many CAT scans that I felt like a rat stuck in a drain pipe. Doctors visited from everywhere, all over the world with their theories and their studies. It was acquired congenital analgesia. It was late onset autism, early onset Alzheimer's, Asperger's. But my favorite was a doctor from Norway who believed it to be a rare bowel disorder that had caused my nervous system to collapse from the pain. I actually laughed because as the slow, regular beeps of my heart turn into a long, flat time, I couldn't give a shit.